My name is Denise Solanos from. I'm going to start by telling you I'm not an expert when it comes to mental health, nor am I an author like these amazing ladies who we have here. But I'll start by telling my story, which I guess it is. My brother, Keith Milano, died by suicide 14 years ago. And I say that just as if he died from cancer. And when we first started saying that 14 years ago, to many people it was a shock that we were discussing this openly. And at the time, my husband and I had an 18-month-old son. So much a shock that my neighbor didn't tell the other people in the neighborhood about my brother's funeral. Why, you might ask? 14 days later, Josie said to me, "I didn't know what you were gonna tell people." And I looked at her and I was just blown away. Blown away because though my brother was bipolar, he battled more the stigma of mental health than he did sometimes with his disease. So we vowed the day he died to make it our mission to talk, because that's how we're gonna reduce the stigma. So I'm usually always myself, my authentic self, and having run a book blog called Mom's Reading, I was approached 6.5 years ago by Katie Ashley, who said to me, "For the month of May, can I donate all the proceeds from my 99-cent book," which at the time, these ladies were probably testing, Amazon didn't let you put books up for free. So Katie had kind of written like a bonus story, didn't really want to make money on it, and I said, "Oh my gosh, we'd be honored to accept your money," because again, I've always talked about Keith, because I kind of, it's the story that we tell. So we just posted online back in the day when social media would actually trend things, and lots of absolutely amazing authors stepped forward and asked, well, first they said, "Why didn't you ask me?" And I said, "Well, I didn't ask anybody, it was Katie's idea." So that first year we raised $12,000. And more importantly, we opened up a dialogue where a number of authors came forward and told about their own struggles. And then so did readers. We will now, for the sixth year this May, and Ginger and Amy Lane, who I'll introduce in a second, will be donating a portion of some of their proceeds this May to the Keith Milano Memorial Fund at the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. So why am I here today? I'm here today moderating this panel because one of the things that many studies have shown, and that this May event has shown for the sixth year, is that when we talk, we reduce the stigma. When we talk, we give people a voice to not just express if something's happened in their life, but to maybe spot it in the person sitting next to them. We tell our children who are 12 and almost 15, "You know what, bud? If you feel sad and you know you probably shouldn't, who would you talk to about that?" And that's a really simple way to break down what is a very complicated disorder that still needs more help and more research. And that's actually where many of the funds that we raise go. Last year, the May Mental Health Awareness Event, just so everyone knows, raised over $30,000. That money is paid direct by the authors to Keith's Memorial Fund at the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. So today, to kind of continue that dialogue, Ginger Scott, Amy Lane, and Heidi Kroon are gonna speak about what they choose, meaning they are amazing authors who put mental health in their stories. And they're gonna weave that in whichever fashion they want to kind of continue the dialogue. I truly believe that words have the power to change, and I know that there have been many books that have these themes that have had readers having comments, readers providing feedback, or some readers even spotting that in those around them. So we actually have to talk about who's gonna start first. So since Ginger's sitting next to me, Ginger gets to start first.
Awesome.
Ginger Scott.
I'm Ginger Scott. Nice to meet everyone. I write young adult and new adult contemporary fiction. And just to kind of be open about me, I suffer from pretty severe anxiety. A lot of people in my family have, you know, struggled with various things. So I grew up in an environment that was pretty open and talked about stuff a lot, which was nice. So when it got to a point where I felt like I couldn't handle moved away from her big fancy city school in Chicago to the suburbs, taken away from all of her friends, and she moves next door to this family, the Harper family, and all of the boys are called Wild. And they're called Wild because their father had a severe mental illness and struggled with medication and would exude behaviors, and in a smaller town people make assumptions and talk and label people. So it's about two boys growing up in that kind of environment and what people label them as, and this girl figuring out who he really is. And I wrote the intro to this, the prologue to this story, and it's based very much on my aunt, who I was very close to, and she suffered with bipolar disorder, but no one really ever talked about it. She never really was diagnosed until later in life, but we all knew that, you know, Aunt Sharon had some good highs going on and some strange lows. And I came home from college to visit her once. I was very close to my family, and I would drive home almost every weekend to see my grandmother, my aunt, my parents. And I came home to visit her, and she had what is called a hypermanic mental break. And it was making her delusional. And I remember visiting my grandmother, who she lived with. They kind of cared for each other. And she was saying a lot of crazy things and talking to some people that weren't there. And she was talking about how she needed to build a defense mechanism. And I went home. I could tell my grandmother was terrified. And I went home and I said, "Mom, something is really wrong with Aunt Sharon." But of course, that's her sister. And she said, "Honey, everything's wrong with Aunt Sharon." And I said, no, something is really wrong. So we, you know, we went back and kind of worked through what was going on. And so at the age of 19, I got to see the other side of mental illness, which is all of the things that my mom went through as sort of the one that was the responsible caretaker to help my aunt get disability, to battle the system that it's very difficult to realize that something like bipolar disorder to this level is disability, and you need to support people, and just explaining the realities of you know, what she has to go through to people. So I saw how hard it is to constantly educate people that are in programs that are help people. So the prologue of the story is very much based on that experience and what I saw my aunt go through. It's fictionalized and it's taken at a really high degree, but something very personal to me. And when I discovered Denise's blog as a reader, and I kind of learned her story, I wanted to be involved. So that's why I reached out to you and said,
"Thank you."
I had to help you do it.
She was one of these. She's like, "How do I get involved?" I'm like, "I'll just say I want to."
Okay.
I'm Amy Lane, and to put it in a very wrong way, my family is buckets of crazy. And if I were to name the list of blood relatives, starting with my mother, who was schizophrenic, and we'll get back to her. And my daughter, my older daughter, who's stunningly beautiful and really brilliant and suffers from anxiety and bipolar depression. My 14-year-old nerd ball son, who was diagnosed with ADD before anyone was even supposed to know he had ADD. You know, kindergarten teacher going, "I'd say he was going to present with an attention deficit, but he has no attention at all." my older son, my oldest, who is now a 6'5" lumberjack with a full beard and the heart of a baby. He has what is known as a communication handicap, and it's not a mental disability, it's not a mental illness, but it did teach me a lot of my coping skills for pretty much anything else thrown my way. And it's a cognitive, it's a processing disorder where in his head, his gears move really well, but getting the information to the gears, it's like for most of us, there's a veil between what someone else is telling us and what we know. For him, there's a brick wall with a couple of gaps. And that's it's schooled a lot of my, informed a lot of my writing. And then there's my stepmom's cousin. Okay. So obviously I have a lot of, you know, fairly intense things going on. I know I have my own mental health issues. You don't get a body like this without eating a lot of rage and sorrow, folks. But starting with my mother, she started out with bipolar issues. And this is what I think, and this is, has been put together. This was like a detective thing through my childhood and my young adulthood. And she started out with bipolar issues. And I was born in 67, and after I was born, there were the 70s, and there was a lot of self-medication with hardcore street drugs while I was a kid. And I remember at one point, because my birthday is the day before hers, and my grandma came visiting, and she had a little cupcake on a platter. And I said, oh, is that for me? And grandma said, no, you can't eat that. I said, okay. I said, can I have some of the frog? No! Like, but it's my birthday too. And I didn't figure out till much later that my mom had been in her room for a week, and these were the meds she wasn't taking, and they were in the frosting. growing up with her was a trip. She was, and still is, extremely cunning. And I know that's not a word you want to associate with mentally ill. But my father was working and going to school at the time, and I would wake up and she would be destroying a part of the house because she knew he was coming home and she was dying. Okay, she had she didn't even have a driver's license. She was home with a kid and he wasn't there, and she was destroying the house and she needed his attention. And he was working and going to school. And again, it was a detective process. Okay, I assumed it was just too much stress to be a mother and to have all that. And I hit my college age and I was like, well, I don't have to be like that. So I spent a lot of my college age proving that I could work the 40 hours and I could get the degree and I could have the relationship. And it was a shock to find out that she had done all the self-medicating, which I had been witness to, and that had changed her brain chemistry. And nobody in her family had told my father. So when she really started losing her shit, he had no idea what was happening. And you put all this together, and you know that mental health issues often run the gamut in the family. And it meant that when my kids were born, I was extremely open with them about it. So dialogue, to me, is really important. When my older daughter started suffering from bipolar depression and anxiety in college, she was away at college, okay? And it's, you'll watch me look at my phone, it doesn't matter who's on it, but it made me like, okay, I will text you at 3 o'clock in the morning if that's what you need, because that open communication was just absolutely vital, and I knew it. And I knew that there, you know, you can't be ashamed of it, because my mom's family was ashamed of her. I don't think my dad would have done quite as much cocaine with her if he had known that it was going to fuck her up that badly, you know? And it changes your perception of mental health as a whole, that you have to be open about it. You have to have dialogues. My children have to know. And yes, we could go visit my mom at her senior care home and where she's lived for almost 40 years, and the kids know. They know that she's not, you know, she's not like my stepmom, who is the perfect grandma. Okay, she's that, and it's going to be different. And Grandma Alexa's going to give you really weird shit that she picked up at garage sales. Just be grateful because she was thinking of you, you know. And that, you know, and well, am I going to grow up to be like Grandma Alexa? Well, probably not. But we do have to keep our eyes open to make sure your brains don't start misfiring. But you know, we'll love you, so you know, you can talk to us. And you just, again, have to keep that dialogue open. And again, like you said, no shame. Being ashamed of what your brain starts doing, okay, against your will, that's rough. And
I think that shows in one of your stories, though.
Thank you. One of the things, and Bobby Green is my most recent story, and actually deals with a character, Reg, who's the other main character in here, is dealing with his sister. And his sister tricked him when he was 16 into signing conservatorship papers. And he wasn't that bright in the first place. And she said, well, you have to do this or I'm going to go into the place, and the bad place, because she had been institutionalized before. And at one point in the story, she goes off her meds and she tricks him into thinking that she's on her meds. And what had happened was she had walked into her monthly appointment with her physician and had gotten a green intern. And she said, yes, I've been off my meds for 2 weeks and I'm doing just fine. And the green intern says, oh, that's okay, you don't need them anymore. And I know people have read that and said, bullshit. It's not such bullshit when it happens to your mother. Because she went from, you know, having a fairly decent regular family life, and not perfect, but living happily in her home, to suddenly escaping, going out on the streets. And I was trying to explain to my uncle, I'm like, okay, Phil, she's probably trying to score. And he's like, that's my baby sister. I'm like, asshole, you did not have my childhood. So knowing that can happen, knowing how, if the family isn't all informed, that he wasn't fully aware of what was going on, because no, he didn't know. Nobody told him what she was like when she was younger. And then I watched her having to climb. There is a institutional ladder that if someone is not taking their meds and they are a danger to themselves, they get the low end of the institution. And it's a terrible place. It is a terrible, terrible place. And they are tied down and injected with the medication until they can take it on their own. And oh my God, if I was Reg, I wouldn't want that to happen either. You know, and they sent me conservatorship papers when I was 2 weeks before I turned 18. Yeah, I was a fairly immature kid. I didn't even have my driver's license. And they sent me the papers that would put me in charge of my mother. Okay? And so it does make me an advocate to at least be aware that the system is that screwed up. At least be aware that we need funding that needs to not be like that. And it does show in my work a lot that it is one of the principal things of my work. I mean, not all, of course, the principal thing of my work is romance. And people can have a happy ever after, which I do believe.
But you need a little bit more than more than that is what keeps the reader engaged and wanting to read.
Yeah. Well, I do have an entire line that is just fluffy and happy ever after. And there's, it's not gonna just hurt that much. But this set of books deals a lot with mental health issues. Denise asked me if I wanted to do this, and I'm like, oh boy, how much do I want to tell the world about my life?
I to be honest, I said you didn't have to say anything.
I know, she did.
I never tell anyone else.
But then I thought, I put these books out into the world, and I had somebody contact me about my uncle and my father are both schizophrenic, and they're not anything like me. And I said, I'm really, really, really happy for you that is your story. Okay, I'm so happy for you, because I don't wish V's story on anybody. You know, I don't wish that to be anybody's reality. I said, but it was mine. And so that was what went down on paper. And I said, it's like, hey, I write these books, people buy these books. I really do need to put up or shut up and explain where this comes from.
Well, thank you for sharing and for turning your story into books that I know help people, because I've seen some of the feedback.
Ready?
Desiree?
I'm going to stand most of the move, so I'll tell my story. I did it. I'm going to pass something out because to help me reference things. I'm going to tell my story a little bit differently. So I have written mental health into a lot of my books, sometimes overtly and a lot of times very subvertly. I feel like the joke in my books is everybody goes to therapy. I mean, like, literally, they go to therapy. Like, how many readers I have in here, but if you go through my books and look, there's a whole lot of people who end up in the therapist's office. or mentioned having gone, and so so I can, I'm giving you, so I, when I reference a book, you can go, oh, that one. A couple of them aren't on here because I'm in the process of reprinting everything. I don't know if you want one, but you're going to get one. And so a couple of them, like one of them I actually really like to reference is not on the page, but so I'm going to stand because the, one of my mental health issues comes from, is like a side effect of, I have pretty bad chronic pain. I'm enjoying it today. I had to have, I had to phone a friend wanting to tape my back, and I will be, once I leave here, I am running to a chiropractor that my husband found while you were all hearing other stories, and vetted with our chiropractor because I need to have my shoulder put back in place. And because until the chronic pain comes with, then, you know, you hurt, and then your brain says, that's not good, and then you panic, and then you panic. My family also has chronic health mental health problems because my husband has chronic depression and anxiety, and my daughter has anxiety. And my husband took him until he was in his mid to late 20s before he began to figure it out, and it's taken him until, I mean, he's still like really trying to get his hands on it, because when you begin to figure it out later in life, it's really harder to get your hands around it. But our daughter, we caught when she was in third grade, and that really changed the game, because it actually helps him, because he was really in a lot of denial about how to take care of it. But as soon as he saw his infant mirrored in her, and, you know, the therapist and I both said, you know, you're the best one to mirror how to manage yourself. And so if you don't manage yourself, that's going to teach her, and that kind of woke him up. And she's really self-actualized and really good about it, and so that has helped a lot. But that, you know, that's a reality of our house. My daughter and my husband both treat their anxiety and his depression like they're like third people in our house, and they're like heart conditions, and it's just this thing that happens that you need to deal with. In the same way that like my chronic pain is something that I need to deal with, like. The fact that I'm wearing a back brace and my shoulder is taped, and I'm wearing tennis shoes instead of nice shoes like everybody else at the con, is because of my disability. And it's just the fact that I have to do. And the same thing with mental health. The problem with mental health is, I'm assuming that some of you in here are either here because you have your own mental health struggles, or you know someone that you love that has them, and so you have an interest. And the problem is that mental health is an invisible disability, and people don't accept it culturally. And so if you need to take a mental health day, people joke about it. It's a joke. Mental health day is a joke. It's not a joke. If you have an anxiety attack or like depression so bad that you can't, so I'm going to cry because it's like so personal to me. If you need to take that day, it's real and you need to do it. And it's really hard to be able to get that if you aren't out to your employer with your disability. And so you have to finagle the way, oh, I have a cold again. Or should I have a cold for 3 days, or what should I do? How, and so, and you're really in a great mental space in that moment to invent this. And so if you have a spouse or a friend or partner who can help you, you're great, but sometimes you don't. I mean, like I was really lucky this morning that I had like a posse of people. I was texting everybody, you know, my husband back home, he's a pharmacist, and you know, I had a team. I was literally crying in my room trying to go, how do I deal with this damn shoulder? I had everybody, but you know, sometimes you don't have that. Sometimes it's you alone trying to figure that out, and that's really rough. And so I, because of my own pain struggles and my family's mental health, it's always in my writing. And so like in, antisocial is kind of a soapbox. We're gonna skip that. But Carry the Ocean is probably the biggest one that people talk about a lot, because one hero is autistic, and the other one has extreme depression and anxiety. And I did that one on purpose because I wanted to highlight the fact that the autistic hero came to me first, but I knew that, and I was really tired of the tropes. I also have worked with teens and adults with disabilities of all kinds, physical and mental, but also with just people with autism on all spectrums, mostly in my youth, but I know population really well, and so So the I get really sick of narratives, story, movies, TV, where how they paint the autistic person, like the good doctor is okay, but it's like only okay. I mean, it makes me angry almost as much as I enjoy it, and I feel like I'm always watching it, like going, you know, I feel like that, because I'm like, you know, like this like idea of like autistic people being real people is really important to me, and so I really wanted to make a hero where he was like, he really was a hero, like he's the best guy on the block. He's just like, you're just waiting for everybody else to catch up to his greatness. And so I wanted to put him with somebody who had an invisible disability. And like his struggle was getting anybody to like actually believe that he had a problem. And I gave him parents that weren't sympathetic. And he does attempt to commit suicide in the book. And it is stopped, but then he goes to the hospital, and so then he runs in, and my husband had to help me with this part, like exactly, because he's a hospital pharmacist, and so like exactly what happens when you get hospitalized for a suicide attempt, and how long you stay, and whether or not you can come out. And I had a great talk therapist forever, and she retired just as I was finishing this book, and our last hurrah together was she beta read that book for me, and like she gave me the aware strategy at the end to put in, and I mean she turned into the best book. And then Shelter of the Sea is a sequel to that, and it's basically them the next day, kind of like they're struggling now in their real life, because the first one was them getting together, and they move into this the most perfect assisted living facility that could never possibly exist. I mean, it's a fairy tale, man. We're gonna go on with it. People will write me, people with disabilities will write me and go, you know that would never exist. I'm like, oh, of course I know. Don't we deserve a little fantasy? Why not? And so, but then in the next one, they like, you know, they take on, they're a little more in the world. And my daughter really loves these books because she read them, and she's the first book she said with Carrie the Ocean, she said, first, I said it in our town that we live in, Ames, Iowa, and she said, Mom, does Emmett live down our street? And I said, yeah. And she said, is there a house? And I said, yeah. And then she said, I think Emmett's room is my room. And the autistic character. And I said, yeah, I kind of use your room. I did. And then she said, I kept waiting for her to say, oh, I really identify with Jeremy because of the anxiety. And she says, you know, Mom, I'm Emmett. And I said, what? And I was like, you know, Anna. And then she got salty, and then she said, I am, because you use me all through the book. And I was like, whoa, step back. And then she laid down all these things. And the thing is that we both sat there and went, oh my God, your whole life suddenly makes sense. Because she has always been super sensitive. She always had trouble with transitions. She doesn't like to look people in the eye. She has a certain time she doesn't want to be touched. Subtle, a little far into the spectrum, but and she like embraced it. So these are her books. Shelter of the Sea is up for Arita. She's coming to the ceremony, and she's like, "It's gonna win." I'm like, "It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way." You know, take that energy. But if it wins, I think I'll give her the trophy because these are her books. I gotta write a third one because she's like, "Where's my cinnamon rolls?" She says. But I mean, like even in the Love Lesson series, which is that gray series further down. That one has is less direct, but there's, you know, it's teenagers struggling with issues of where I belong, and several of them end up in the therapist's office in different ways, and they coach each other through. And there's people with social anxieties, people dealing with coming out, and then a book that's not on here that's currently being republished by Dream Center Press. I have a character with OCD. And social anxiety, and another book that's not on here. They do have had like one copy with me. I was going to write it down, but the aforementioned panic attack upended my plans. And but it is historical. But I have the Earl's son has an extreme stammer, which at the time they branded them like completely like they were like. Unworthy, like don't have kids with them, they'll pass it on, and of course it's gay, and but he had extreme social anxiety too, and so I mean I really love writing books about broken heroes and heroines, because because they're not broken, they're just different, and I like making, giving them agency and happy labor after and twisting the thing. Because for, I mean, and like Dance With Me is all about somebody with chronic pain and somebody who had a debilitating loss, and they get together, and like this football player who like nearly killed himself with a neck injury, and now he has, he basically has chronic pain. And so, and I had a lot of time with that book, and but a reader wrote me from Canada and said that book really meant a lot to me because, you know, you really got chronic pain right, and I'm suffering from that. I said, there's a reason for the chronic pain, right? And we've been emailing each other for years, and we've talked each other through really hard times and disappointments, and sent each other presents. She went on, I can't do this. We had a cat of 17 years who passed away, and we were all like really devastated because he was like the buddy. She has this horrible back issue, and she went to school by lying in the back of the room because she couldn't sit in a chair. But she used to be a really great pianist, and she sat at the piano, even though it hurt, and played me a song. I recorded it and sent it to me when my cat died. And I mean, I know how that, I mean, that meant so much to me because I'm like, you heard for me, man. You didn't need to do that. But I mean, so it's like, I mean, that's a sort of, I mean, that's like a novel now. I'm not putting that in there. It's going in. But I mean, that's the sort of stuff that I feel like the same thing with mental health and chronic pain and all that. It needs to be in there because these are people who don't get stories. And just because you have a mental illness or any disability, any kind of illness, the society tries to tell you that there's no happy ever after for you, or your path is closed, no one will want to love you, or you can't find love, you can't, you know, I mean, but the opposite, of course, is completely true. You know, I got up and there was no way I could get down to this table when I had five friends who taped me and carried me and held my hand and, you know, calmed me down and, you know, told me, well, I think the makeup is done now. But I mean, you know, people do that. That's real life is not that narrative, and we need more stories that do that. And I think that's if any of you are writers in here or want to be writers, there I encourage you to put that in your fiction in any way possible, because whether you write all about it or you just stick it in, put a disabled person, someone with mental illness anywhere in your book. Anywhere. Whether you make them a hero, a heroine, somewhere on the side who's just awesome, not sad sack, please no sad sacks. But I mean, the world needs more of that, because let me tell you, every time that happens, someone will write you and thank you, because I get them all the time. You wanna know how many letters I get about Carrie the Ocean? I get them like every day, and every one of them makes me cry. Because it's like somebody who's like, you totally, like, they're like, I handed this to my cousin and now they understand my depression. Mm-hmm. I handed this to my spouse and now they understand my depression. I mean, or now I understand my autistic son better. Or I mean, it's like this, I mean, yes, they're just romance. No, they're not just romance. I mean, but they can help people. And so, and if you're reading or looking for books to read more books that, you know, that as soon as you see that there's going to be something about mental illness, read them, because it helps everybody. It helps you understand people that just haven't come out to you, and you'll know how to look for them because they're right beside you. They're everywhere. They're sitting in this room. They're walking down the halls. They're just trying not to let you see because we're not supposed to let you. Sorry, I did not mean to cry all over my section of the presentation.
Thank you.
I have some in my bag. Thank you.
Questions for these amazing ladies and their beautiful stories? Done? Question? Yay! Sorry.
I'm thinking that there's portrayal of people who have mental health issues, mm-hmm. and then there's portrayal of the people who are not dealing with, but interacting with and coping with people who have mental health issues. And I know some people have been criticized in writing romances for taking that second position and using mental health as
she has a life of her own. She has a personality of her own. She has a good, happy place where she could be. And she could have her own story. I'm not going to write it. I generally write gay romance.
I was going to say, wait, you don't write about girls. Yeah. The girls I've asked for stories for.
If I could find a publisher, I actually have a couple, but you know, I'm not going to write her story. I could. You know, I portray her as her brother has all these handsome friends because he's in porn. And she gets crushes on them. She's embarrassed. So I give her all the humanity in the world that when she tricks her brother into I'm taking my meds, there's some discussion about how she doesn't want to be not have any agency. She doesn't want to be dependent on drugs. She doesn't want to have her reality altered for her. It's embarrassing, you know, for her. This is humiliating that she has to be dependent on her baby brother. So I make her as human as possible. I have another character in another book in this series, Ethan Gold, and he ends up in an institution for life. And we visit him, and he too has a boyfriend, and he is dealing with, and what I want for these characters is for them to have the, you know, I may not tell that story because I'm telling this other guy's story, but they have their own story. They are their own person. And that's not, that's not exploited. They have their own, they're not, hey, this is a badge for, we have mental health issues.
And on the other side, you, with the caretaker side, the thing is that the thing that would be, the trap is, if you haven't experienced this yourself, it's difficult to know what the, if you've experienced it, you don't have to worry, just tell the truth. If you haven't, then the thing to know is, like as a caretaker of my husband, if you want to, you just be real. And the reality is, you make mistakes, and it's hard, and you get tired, and you get angry,
yes.
And you aren't a saint. I mean, you have, there are days when you're loving, like my husband was my caretaker just now, and it was really easy for him because I'm a million miles away, and he can't do much, and so he's like, okay, I'm calling, and I'm doing, and I'm going to make this phone call, I'm going to do this, because he can't do anything. But when I'm there, and he comes home from work and the dishes aren't done again and the house is a mess and I'm still sitting in the chair and it's the third day in a row and he knows it's because I hurt, but it's like, Jesus, Lord. I mean, that stuff happens. And so it's like the I understand intellectually, but in the reality I'm kind of tired. And there's also just like for example, like in Shelton Sea, the good part of it is that so Jeremy and Emma got together in book one because it's romance. And in book two, though, their big struggle is I wanted Jeremy to not be better. Like, because, I mean, he's still anxious, and I wanted him to be worse, in fact, because that happens a lot. And so Emma's struggle is, I mean, he has his own baggage because he's autistic, and he wants the world to be a certain way, and he can't, his lover is just not lining up in any way that he can figure out how to work around. So he's struggling very hard to figure out how to put his without upsetting his lover, and how to figure out without upsetting himself. And that seems overdone because, you know, you go, oh, well, that's because he's autistic. It's not. It's just really overdrawn because the lines are so clear. But that's really anybody. It's everybody going, well, I want to be upset right now, but I really feel like I can't because you're so sick. And I do the same thing with my husband. When you know, I've had a good day and he comes home and he starts sighing and goes and lies in the other room, and I'm like, I just need help, and I'm hurt too, by the way, jerk. I mean, you know, it's like, it's like, that's real.
Yeah.
That's real. But when everybody, I mean, I call bullshit when I read a book and everybody's like, oh, yes, I will take care of you and everything is great. I'm like, that's good for a day or two. And then there better be some cussing and some like vet to the friend. I mean, there better be a best friend on call going, God, I'm tired. I'm tired of this.
Well, and to get the person, if you have your caretaker is your main character, that the person that's taking care of needs their own humanity, and that the caretaker needs limits. I have a story called Summer Lessons, where it's two brothers rooming together, and one of I was writing his story as I was writing the first one. His story's coming. I already have him lined up. I think he's already, we've already seen the romance beginning. So everybody knows his story coming. But his brother is talking to his boyfriend going, well, how was Dane today? It's a big deal for the boyfriend because the boyfriend's just now starting to realize that other people exist. Mm-hmm. And he's like, so did your brother have, how was your brother today? And he says, well, honestly, Mason says, honestly, he's a butthurt fucking asshole. Because when I deal with my daughter with bipolar disorder, when it gets bad, oh my God, she's a twat. She's horrible. She's every parent's worst nightmare of having to deal with an adolescent, and she's 23. But I know that she's in pain and she's lashing out. But if I don't lash out to someone, I'm gonna lose my shit. So there has to be that interchange of that close twining of love and just fucking irritation.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's not real.
I think you guys are both right. You have to have that authentic element to it. And like I said, I tried to really weave in that caretaker view because that's what I watched. And I mean, sometimes it was hard on her. It was stressful and very hard on her. And in this book, everyone gets the same label, but one of the brothers just sort of steps up into that caretaker role. And one of them turns to all of those self-medicating things. And it just, I tried to show how hard it was on the one who just willingly took on the role, and he wants to get rid of the role so bad. So bad. He doesn't want to be in charge of this, but who else is going to be in charge of it? And you can just see him sometimes going like, I should just let you just go off. Whatever happens to you, happens to you, and it's your fault. But, then you pull yourself back in because it's guilt. And obligation and love, but sometimes love and wanting to take care of your own sanity is really hard. So I think when you're writing, sometimes those are the parts that are hard to tell, and you start to think, oh, I'm making this character pretty ugly, but ugly's real.
Ugly's real.
Yeah, ugly's real.
I mean, you can yell in one chapter and make up in another.
Yeah.
I mean,
because that's what we do in real life.
Yeah.
I could have yelled at someone this morning, and then later I'm like, well, you want to share?
So, I mean, on that same line, what's really great, even in Family Man, my writing partner, Marie Sexton, that's in that second row, that one was born out of a real story about someone very close to her who is a functional alcoholic, but who made things worse by nearly killing herself by adding cough syrup. And what happened was she nearly died but did not. And it came to the point where this person said, the person closest to her said, I wish she would have died because it would have been easier because it was such a prolonged, this is just hard, and that was really hard to say. And Marie wanted to put this in this book, but it was really hard for her to write that, and she wanted me to write that scene, and we got there, and I'm like, honey, that's gotta be you. And so I basically held her hand in chat while she wrote it, and I think she went through up afterward. But I mean, she still gets me. And it's funny, nobody ever said, you can't, we wrote different parts throughout the whole book, and we never said who wrote what, and who wrote what part, but everybody who cures gets the email, they all knew she wrote that part. I mean, so it's good, it's healthy, but I mean, it means something to people because there's all kinds of children of alcoholics who write her and say, thank you, that really made me feel better because that helped me get rid of my guilt, like permission.
Because it's real.
Yeah.
We don't always embrace the role. Sometimes, God, we don't want it. And that's what we would say.
And it's okay. I mean, ugly is okay sometimes because sometimes life is really ugly.
And the thing is that you try and draw the line between, the caretaker and the exploited person with the mental health issue, but there's no clear line demarcation because it is a relationship, which means that there is action and reaction on both sides. And if you're writing authentic characters that you feel are real, the people that you talk to and, when you're walking the dogs, those people are real in your head. If you're writing those people real in your head, not, he, his IQ isn't below 85, which is, I think, the official for, but he's not, he hasn't, his formal education was made worse because his mother was also schizophrenic. His, you know, he was just not one of those kids who recovered really well in terms of you know, I have an unusual brain, so school was my safety. He was not, and that was one of the questions I asked myself. What would it be like if school hadn't been my safety, if I hadn't had an unusual brain? What if I hadn't had a safety net and my mother put her conservatorship papers on my hand? What would my life be like? And the answer was a lot like Reg's, you know? So and I guess all of our answers is to make so that it's not exploitive, so that make sure you're talking about real human beings. And these are if it's not, you know, if the person, if the main character isn't the one with the mental health difficulty, the people they're dealing with are still human beings to us.
Does anybody have any more questions?
There we go. So in talking about resolving conflict, when mental illness is both part of the character and part of the conflict, and the answer isn't going to be, and the character's all better, happy ever after, this will be fine, how do you resolve that conflict without fixing?
They go through without giving away the whole thing. They basically figure out ways for him to practice accepting his panic attacks, like, and learning how to manage. Like, he's practicing the aware strategy, and they set goals and bars, and like when you, and they say basically when you do this, we'll do this cool thing together. And then he eventually figures out how to do. And it's a marginal thing. Basically, he learns how to walk through as a target. And that was his big thing, and he does, and then they do this cool thing, and it's the big kind of climax of the book. And in the second book, he has another, they have another thing they have to learn how to do, which is a little less, it's focused on mental health, but it's more broad, it's like everybody's mental health. And they had to come to terms with what happens when it doesn't, when people don't help you, basically. So what do you do when everybody's not going to help you, and now you have to go solve your own mental health problems, or deal with the fact that, you know, you tried and everybody said screw you, and what do you do then? And then it's again, it's community, how do you help each other and things like that. And in Dirty Laundry, he had OCD, and his OCD is that he has other little facets to it, but it's mostly, his biggest problem is he can't handle, this would be fine because this is a public space, it's a designated public space. But he can't be in a hotel room because that's way too confusing. But your house is your house, and other people don't belong in it. And my house is my house, and other people don't belong in it. So he can't go visit his boyfriend, and the boyfriend can't visit him. They have sex in lots of other places. But he can't progress. to is, and it always boils down to, how do I accept my mental health? And
yeah.
my personal mental health needs, and they are different from other people's. And
I saw one more hand. I think we probably have time for one more question.
Oh, I just was going to ask if with Ginger's YA, sometimes kids are going through stuff, and they can be happy at times when they do grow out of the depression.
Mm-hmm.
I
we can hope.
Yeah.
Hope.
Yeah.
I like the word
hope. The
hope.
Yeah, there's always hope.
Which is why Happy for Now works, because
yeah.
well,
it's hopeful.
Let's see, I was going to address that too. How do you have, for a lot of it is the knowledge that the issue doesn't go away, and that it's not, that these people may be together and we may have all the hope in the world for the relationship.
But they're not better.
But the, yeah, they're not better. The first of the story, Chasing Shadow, and
that's your book in the fundraiser.
Yes, that's my fundraiser. I'm not giving too much away because this happens in the first chapter. In the first chapter, Chase starts with a razor blade to his wrist. And he keeps saying, but I stopped. I only cut one. And then everybody else is like, no, it doesn't count. yeah. And at the end, he's lost weight. He's going to be on antidepressants for the rest of his life. He's going to be dealing with these, and there's that knowledge. And that's, for me, is that ever-present knowledge, is that this issue is not, it's not magically disappeared
right.
by the power of your lover's magic wing. It doesn't happen. The issue is still there. The pain is still there. But it's manageable, and now we have a hope that there is a navigation.
I think it's the awareness of it.
Yes.
And it's, and the book gives the lesson of that now we're all aware of it. And
yeah, awareness
is
acceptance.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah, and this is now part of our relationship.
I was
going to
say, I think it... Maybe it becomes more just one part of yourself instead of
yes.
the
big
part
yeah.
that we
yes.
have to
yeah.
deal with. That
yeah.
it becomes more normalized and
less
right.
shame.
It, well, yeah.
yeah,
but I mean, as a couple too, it's just one part of yourself that you
yeah.
have to share.
Yeah,
yeah. Like with
and
me, when you're in a relationship with me, you get me and my anxiety. It's like a bonus.
Right. It's under control. That's
yeah.
one part of you, and then there's the part that likes. You know,
yeah.
do whatever else.
Yeah, and check my backpack.
It's not out
sure
of proportion.
That, like, it's really in there.
It's not out of proportion, right? Like what an alcoholic is drinking,
yeah.
that's really all you deal with. You don't deal with the nice parts.
Mm-hmm.
When it's under control, you deal with, yes, you're still an alcoholic, but you're also, you know, great at Scrabble and you
right.
can go
right.
to the symphony and, you know.
That's nice. That's a nice way to put it.
Well, I want to thank these amazing ladies for sharing their story. Way more personal than I thought it would be, so. And I managed not to cry, so I'm excited. And I want to thank everyone for coming.